have a Bible this morning, of course, I pray that you bring it with you every week. Open it to John chapter 6. In John chapter 6, we see a very familiar story in the first 15 verses of how Jesus feeds the multitudes. I call it multitudes because we're so casual with Jesus feeds the 5,000 that it's actually many more than that, so let's just call it multitudes. And every time I read this story, it makes me wonder why people ask questions like this. How can God use me? Or it makes me wonder why people ever think negative thoughts like this. Why would God ever use me? Or worse yet, God can't use me. What I have is not enough to offer to change the church, and whether it be my time that I give, I don't have enough to give. It's not going to make an impact. My talents are not great enough. They're not going to affect anybody else. My tithe is so meager. Look at all these other people with all this other money. Let them do it. I know God's not going to use mine anyway. Nonsense. Nonsense. God has always been in the business of using ordinary people like you and like me to do extraordinary things. God has always been in the business of using things that you don't think that you have enough of, multiplying them and making them into something you could never thought that would be. Remove that nonsensical thought that God can't, doesn't want to use you or what you have for whatever reason, especially if you do not think that it's enough. You say, okay, Pastor, I'll start with that. I'll work with that. How could God use me? I don't know. I don't know. But I know that God can do whatever He wants to do. And He wants to use you. I know He used Hattie Mae, a young girl in the late 1800s in Philadelphia. Her family was poor. They didn't have much of anything. But there was this little church next to her home called Grace Baptist Church there in Philadelphia. And so she decided one Sunday to just go to the Sunday school. It was a small church, but they were crowded in their children's department. A lot of children came to Sunday school. And there Hattie Mae learned about Jesus, what He has done and what He can do for her. She met the pastor who at the time was Reverend Russell Conwell. And when he saw Hattie Mae in the hallway, he apologized to her. After he introduced himself and said, "My name is Pastor Conwell, and your name is Hattie Mae." He said, "Honey, I'm sorry that it's so crowded here. But one day, we're praying that God allows us to expand this building so that we can have more little girls like you come to Sunday school." I'm sure he quickly forgot that conversation, although he would be reminded of it later. But she did not quickly forget that conversation. Hattie Mae went home. And every time she would get a penny, not an extra penny, that she would get any penny, she would save that penny. And she would save every penny that she had. Why? For one purpose, that she could give it to the church so they could build more room for more girls like her to come to Sunday school. It's a sweet story turned sad because Hattie Mae had a disease that she didn't know at the time, and it would soon take her life. The pastor went to her parents' house. They asked him to do the services. He said, "Of course I will." They were in her room looking around, and they found her dingy, torn little purse laying on the floor. They picked it up and it had some change in it. Thought that was interesting. In the late 1800s, not many people had any change. But they picked it up and they found 57 cents. Now you're thinking that's not much, but for a young, poor, poverty-stricken girl in the 1800s, 57 cents was a lot of money for anybody. And they found a note describing how she wanted every one of those 57 pennies to go to the church to build a larger department of Sunday school so more children could go there. Now, it may have been a significant amount of money for a little girl and most people, but you're probably thinking, that couldn't have even scratched the surface, Pastor, of building a building. Oh, but it did. Because the pastor told that story to his deacons. They were so excited about it, they said, "Pastor, you got to share this with the church." The pastor shared that story with the church, and that 57 cents turned into $250, which is a lot of money in the 1800s. And suddenly that $250 went to purchase a house. That house later allowed the congregation to expand, and later they purchased some more land. And that land today is where Temple Baptist Church in Philadelphia is. And there's 3,000 seats in there. Not only that, but a little college called Temple College came out of that same ministry, of the foundation of 57 cents. You now know it as Temple University. Thousands of students go there. A hospital came out of that ministry called the Samaritan Hospital, now Temple University Hospital, where thousands of people are ministered to every year. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, what God can do with 58 cents, 57 cents. And what can God do with you is the question. Look in John chapter 6. This young boy didn't have 57 cents, but he had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And once again, we see another story of Jesus using a young child to teach the principle that whatever you have is enough if you let him multiply it. So let's dig into the story together and find out that Jesus, once again, if you haven't believed it yet through these stories, if you haven't been here yet, that Jesus is powerful. See it and believe it. Therefore, he can do abundantly more than you with far less than you think that you have. He comes to the Sea of Galilee from Jerusalem, and you almost can see the mob scene behind him. At least 5,000 men were following him. So what does Jesus do? He hops in a boat and he crosses over the Sea of Galilee, which was a significant trek. I've been on the Sea of Galilee. It's a beautiful place, but to go across will take you some amount of hours. The people just continued to follow him. They went around and met him on the other side. Now, on the other side, there weren't as many people, not as many towns, but you know what there was? A lot of space. So Jesus, the Bible says, went up on the mountain, more like a hill, more like the mountains in Texas, and he sat overlooking the Sea of Galilee, and he began to do what? He began to teach. That's what a rabbi would do. He would find a place where he could have lots of people gather, and he'd sit at an elevated position, and he would teach them. Just like God taught Moses on the mountain when he gave him the Ten Commandments. Just like Jesus as God would later teach the Sermon on the Mount. And he sat down to symbolize his authority in teaching as a rabbi. This is what Jesus did. He taught in authority. Now, we don't have recorded here what he taught. But it must have been a long teaching, or it took them a long time to get there, because at some point, he feels the burden of the people that are there. How large is the crowd? It said, how many? 5,000. Anybody go to the Ennis game on Friday night? Sorry if it's still painful. It hurts me too. How many people do you think were there? Maybe like 5, 6, 7, 10? Yeah, 10, 11,000 people. Well, you say, okay, it's smaller than that crowd. No, no, no. When Jesus had them sit down for lunch, which that's going to be amusing here in a minute, it says he said the men numbered 5,000 people. It didn't count the women and children. Which you know there were children there, because who did Jesus use to borrow his bread and fish? A little boy. Most commentators believe that there's probably more like 20,000 people here. Twice the crowd that you saw Friday night as Ennis played Waxahachie. Now remove that thought from your mind so we can focus. Jesus turns to Philip and said, It occurs 4 different times in 4 different Gospels. It's basically something like this. Hey, let's feed these people. Go get them something to eat. Philip takes a quick survey of the 20,000 people and realizes, even if I had 6 to 8 month salary, that's what 200 denarii is, 6 to 8 month salary, which I don't know about you, I don't carry 6 to 8 months of my salary in my pockets. I mean, you may have a card that has access to that, but they carry their money then. Not only do we not have that money, but even if we had that amount of money, it wouldn't be enough to feed all of these thousands of people even one bite. So he looks at Jesus and basically says, it's impossible. And I want you to remember what I believe Jesus was thinking. Oh, really? I believe that thought crossed Jesus' mind. Oh, really? So then Andrew, the brother of Peter, speaks up and he goes, yeah, well, we have this little boy over here. That's the only food I can really see around. And he's got 5 loaves of barley bread, which, by the way, that's the cheapest stuff you could buy. It was the bottom shelf stuff. We got 5 loaves of bread and a couple of these pickled fish that he brought with him today. But Jesus, that doesn't amount to a hill of beans compared to the 20,000 people that are here. What do you think Jesus is thinking again? Oh, really? Have the people sit down for lunch and watch this. As you go into verse 10 and 11, you see what happens. Jesus began to break the bread. And as he handed it, there would always be more bread to break. And he handed out the bread and he handed out the fish in the same way, to the tune of enough bread and enough fish to feed this 5,000 to even 20,000 people. But what did they have? Did they have enough to eat? It said they ate all that they wanted. But not only that, what was there? Leftovers, y'all. How many leftovers? Enough to fill 12 baskets full of the leftover bread. This is not a nursery rhyme. This is not a pretend story. This legit miracle happened. The people are like, okay, there's something different about this guy. Look at verse 14. Therefore, when the people saw the sign which Jesus had performed, they said, truly, this is the prophet who is come or has come into the world. At this point, the crowd was willing to follow him around the lake. But don't call them followers yet, just because they followed him around the lake. I still think they're fans. They came, maybe not for the food, but they came for the signs, the Bible says. Now remember, John, every time he sees Jesus do a miracle, he calls it a sign and not a miracle, because the sign was always supposed to point to somewhere else. And they saw for the first time that this miracle of feeding the 20,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish, they see it as a sign, but they see it as the wrong sign. See, this prophet, the prophet they were thinking of that Jesus was, they're thinking he was like the prophet Moses. This is Passover. Like, why does the author tell me it's Passover? Well, Passover was the time of year that was like 4th of July times 100 for us, where they celebrated the fact that God passed over Egypt and the nation of Israel so that what? They could be delivered from the hand of sin and oppression by who? A guy named Moses. They're looking at Jesus to be like Moses. The problem is, Jesus is trying to help them understand, no, Moses wanted to grow up to be like me. They had it twisted. They had it wrong. Everything that Moses did is his life story, especially the Passover and the deliverance from sin and oppression from the nation of Egypt, was seen in a greater way through Jesus Christ. You know that they don't get it from verse 15. So Jesus, perceiving that they got it wrong, basically, they were intending to come and take him by force and do what? Make him their king. He withdrew again to the mountain by himself to be alone. Jesus could have owned that opportunity and said, take me, I'll be your king. But Jesus didn't come to lead a revolt. He came for so much more. Yes, Moses led the people of Israel out from the land of sin and oppression under Egypt, but Jesus came to do something greater, to lead us out of our sin and oppression that is keeping us from heaven and in a place called hell, and leading us not to a promised land, but the promised land, his promised land, and an eternity in heaven with him. Jesus is the greater Moses, but they didn't see it. They were close, but not there yet. Now, this is an amazing story of the power of Jesus. And the fact that, like that bread, the day was broken, his body was broken. And he wanted a people, they didn't get it quite yet, but he wanted a people to see his power so that when they saw his body broken on the cross and they saw the empty tomb that symbolized the resurrection, that they would look to him as more than a leader of a revolt or a king. They would look to him as the king and the savior of the world. This is all working together. But at this point in the story where John has placed this, I have some observations I want to leave with you today that literally you can put in your pocket again and walk away and have something with you for a lifetime. The first thing I want you to see, before the miracle even occurred, Jesus tested Philip. Look here. I want you to see that in Christ, you should expect your faith to be tested. Jesus could have come. He could have showed up with the 20,000 people. He could have performed the miracle, and they would have seen him the same way that they saw him in the story. But he didn't just perform the miracle. What did he do first? He took an opportunity to teach his disciples about faith. He wanted to see if Philip realize what was going on here. He wanted to see if Philip knew that he was standing next to God in the flesh. He wanted to see if Philip understood that with God, all things are possible. Unfortunately, Philip missed it a little bit. All he could think about was, whoa, there's no way, Lord. There's no way we can feed all these people. But I want to tell you today, ladies and gentlemen, if you're a follower of Christ, you may be sitting there like the disciples were. You need to expect to have your faith tested. You need to expect, if the Lord Jesus is guiding you, to come into God-ordained situations where you look at them and say, I don't think I can do that. Lord, I don't think that's possible. And Jesus wants to look back at you and say, exactly. Without me, it's not possible. But with me, all things are possible. You may be there today like some of the other who gathered. You may not be a believer. Maybe you came here today just to see if Jesus is real or not. Oh, he's real and he's powerful. Not only does he have the power over fish and bread, but he has the power over life, death, and eternity to be your Savior today. But if you are a disciple, don't go into situations where you see it as impossible and be downtrodden. Don't go into situations where you think it's impossible and believe that it's impossible and give up on it. Go into situations and be prepared for God to make you strong and courageous, not terrified, not discouraged, and not turning away. And don't be surprised if those tests come often, because they will. Was it not Joshua who had to take the reins of leadership from Moses? Do you remember Joshua chapter 1, as Moses disobeyed and Moses died? But God's plan did not die. He looks to Joshua and says, now you're the man. Joshua's probably like, what? You want me to do what? Lead all these people? These slaves? To cross this river Jordan, where there are armies and there are cities, i.e. Jericho, that we have no chance against? Lord, I don't know if I can do that. God knew that Joshua was terrified and dismayed. But what did God say to Joshua? Exactly what he wants to say to you today. Three times in Joshua chapter 1, as you are facing those impossible obstacles in your life, God says to Joshua, be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. And the third time in Joshua chapter 1, verse 9, God says, have I not already commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. Why? For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. If you were a follower of Christ today, if you were a disciple, the Lord your God is with you wherever you go through the power of Jesus Christ that lives inside of you through the Holy Spirit. Not one time in your life do you have to be terrified and discouraged and depressed. Not one time in your life do you have to believe that the lie that Satan is trying to sell you that says, I can't do it, I don't have enough, I can't do enough. Not one time do you have to believe that. Because God is always with you. But don't be surprised if he tests that faith that you say that you have. Not only did Jesus test Philip, I don't want you to miss that. But let's next look at how he did a whole lot with a very little. I want to tell you today, believer, that you need to let Jesus multiply what you do have and stop worrying about what you don't have. Can I say that again? Let Jesus multiply what you do have in your pocket, in your talents, with your time, right now, and stop worrying about what you don't have. We get it twist. We get it the wrong way around. I meet so many believers, and I look at a believer every day in the mirror where I spend most of my time, where you spend most of your time, worrying about what we don't have. Let it go. And say, God, here I am. Use me. Lord Jesus, this is what I have, and all of it's yours. And see what he does with it. See what he does with it. He is in the business of multiplying what you consider insignificant to become more than you could ever imagine. Picture this little boy. Poor. Barley bread. That was the least of bread. It didn't last very long and it didn't taste very good. But that's all he had. Two pieces of fish. Likely they were pickled or dried, because he didn't have enough money to go to a fisherman on the side of the lake of the sea, or lake side of the Sea of Galilee, and buy two fresh fish. That's all he had. You know what Jesus says? It's enough. In fact, it's more than enough. The point was to Philip and everybody who was watching is that the task, yes, it was impossible. Even if Jesus' disciples could get that amount of food to feed the 20,000, if they could get that amount of money, it wouldn't be enough. The task literally was impossible. Philip didn't have much money, probably didn't have 8 months of wages, but you know what he probably did have? He probably had enough in his pocket to go buy more fish and bread than this little boy had. But that's why Jesus chose to use the little boy. He wanted to show Philip that he could do far more than Philip thought possible with far less than Philip had. If you could get this point, you'd be going somewhere. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is God. He can take whatever you have and multiply it to make it enough. And in fact, more than enough. Look at Ephesians 3:20. There's many more scriptures we could look at, but Paul says it the same way. In the NIV from Ephesians 3:20, Paul says, "Praise Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine according to His power that is at work within us." Immeasurably more than you could ever ask or imagine. If this is true, why would you ever think that He can't use you? If this is true, why would you ever think that what you have is not enough? It's immeasurably more than enough than even what you're thinking about to even ask Him. If He can use this boy's fish and bread, if He can use Hattie Mae's 57 cents, what do you think He can do with you? How much more bread do you have? How much more money do you have? I want to tell you today, stop doubting and start believing. Stop doubting and start obeying. Stop holding on to what you have, thinking that you don't have enough. Stop holding on to what you have and think it's not enough. Just give what you have to Jesus and see what He can do with it. With this in mind, I want to debunk a couple lies that many of you are believing today. Number one, I hear you say this. I don't want you to believe it. I'm such a failure. God can't use me. You may have come in here today thinking you're unworthy to be used by God. You say, "Pastor, I've done too many bad things for God to use me." Pastor, if you only knew the bad things that I have done, you would agree with me and with God that He cannot, nor does He want to use me. You know what I say to that? Baloney. There's other words, but I'm going to use baloney. Listen, I get fired up about this because it's destroying Christianity today. I know for a fact that God wants to use you because He's used me. And like you, I was born a miserable sinner. But through the power of Christ, God takes that miserable, unuseful sinner and He turns it into something useful and beautiful. The fact that you're sitting there feeling like you're unworthy to be used by God lets me know that you're at the exact point where He wants to use you. You just have to start believing it. I'm not worried about that person that believes God can't use them. I believe you can see that God will use you. I'm worried about the person that's sitting there thinking, "I don't need to be used by God." Or, "I don't need God worse yet." Be humble enough to think that you need Him, because once you think that you need Him and He can use you, He will. Do not forget that God is in the business of using ordinary people to do extraordinary things. You say, "Pastor, I messed up." Well, guess what? So am I. God is in the business of using messed up people to do amazing things in His name. I hear this all the time. "Well, Pastor, give me an example in the Bible of when God used somebody that was messed up." No. Let me ask it another way. Give me an example in the Bible where God used somebody that wasn't messed up. Do you remember Noah? At one time, he was a drunk. Abraham was too old. Sarah was way too old. They laughed at God when He said, "You're going to have a kid." And they did. His name was Isaac. Abraham once called his wife his sister just to save face. What about Jacob? Right, the father of the patriarchs. He was a terrible father and a liar. Moses, yeah, he stuttered. But worse than that, he doubted and even disobeyed God. Moses even killed a man. What about David? He was too young and ruddy, right? Wrong. God used him. He too had a man killed and had an affair with another woman as the king of Israel. Hosea's wife, a prostitute. Samson did amazing things for God. And he was a sinful and lustful man who didn't even wear a suit and who had long hair. I know that's personal for some of you, but I'm sorry, he did. You go to the New Testament, God used Lazarus. You know what Lazarus was? Dead. Think about Paul. He spent most of his life killing Christians. And then he met Christ and maybe goes down in history as the greatest Christian. And oh, even Peter denied Jesus 3 times. Hear me today. You may have failed, but you're not a failure. Through Christ, you can be forgiven. And if you're a believer, repent, come back to Christ so he can forgive you again, and you can be used by him again. No one is too far gone for Jesus. Trust in Christ. He has made you worthy. Number two, you believe this, and I want to tell you it's nonsense. God doesn't want to use me. He wants to use somebody else. This usually starts with the thought that God doesn't need me. And although that's true, God doesn't need you. He doesn't need anyone or anything. But he's something better. He wants to use you. He allows you the opportunity to participate with him in his greatness of spreading his glory around the world. Sure, God could use somebody else, but listen to me. He wants to use you. And when I say you, you're like, oh, maybe him or her. No, no. The you that is sitting there thinking it's not me, I'm talking to you. He is just waiting to use you. He is giving you a unique gift that nobody else has exactly like you. He's giving you a unique position at this point in your life, at work, at school, at home, that nobody else has that position in that circle of friends. He's giving you a unique opportunity to be you and represent him. You're special to God. He created you that way for this season, at this time. Seize the opportunity. Of course God wants to use you. And of course God can use you if you would just give him a chance. Give Jesus what you have. Your time, your talents, and your tithes. Even if you think that they are meager. And watch him multiply them. I remember 4 years ago when we started reaching or trying to reach the river people. Do you remember that? It's over 4 years ago now. They were too far away. In a place that had never had the gospel taken to them, as far as we know, in the last 2,000 years. I know what you were thinking. You're thinking what I was thinking. This is an impossible task. If it hadn't been done in 2,000 years, how are we going to do it, this little church in Ennis, Texas? And if we would have believed that, it wouldn't have been done. And we would have missed out on these tremendous blessings, but we didn't say that, did we? You said yes. And everybody that doubted, you know what Jesus was saying, just like he said to his disciples in his mind? Oh, really? It's too far away? Oh, really? We started a funding strategy called Project 138, where we said we want everybody who goes to have their total trip paid for. That's impossible, people said. Oh, really? It's happened with every person on every trip in the last 4 years. We partnered with a young man named Danny, who wasn't an American, who was an Indonesian, didn't even know English, had barely come out of school. He was wet behind the ears and as green as you could be. He's too young. He doesn't know enough. In fact, he's going too far in. He will not make it more than 6 months. Oh, really? He's been there for years, preaching the gospel every day. People have been saved and baptized, and soon he is marrying a woman that has the same vision as him to share the gospel with the ends of the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, God has done it before. I could list 1,000 stories, but I want you to be prepared for how he's going to do it again. An ordinary person, that's you, that God wants to do extraordinary things with. I can't help but think about Kelly Boston in this moment. I didn't even mention it in the first service. Think about Kelly Boston. I mean, I love the guy, but ordinary. Horticulture teacher at a high school, small town Texas. God used him to reach thousands of people. How? He didn't come from a rich family, as far as I know. He didn't graduate from Harvard. He wasn't a TV actor. He wasn't a politician. He was just a dude in high school who loved Jesus and loved kids. He didn't have a social media platform. He wrote notes. He had real conversations, and he leveraged what he did have for Jesus. He gave it to Jesus. You know what Jesus did with it? He multiplied it again and again and again, and he's still multiplying it today. And if you talk to those who knew Kelly, they said he really just got on fire 5 years ago. All of that started 5 years ago. Please stop buying the lie that God can't use you. I'm just one person. Yeah, you're one person. Think about what God can do with you. But not only can he use you, will he use you, but he's going to use you again in the future. In just about a month, maybe less than a month, I'm going to bring you a project. It's a building project. We've been considering all these amazing things in Jerusalem, not yet Jerusalem, but Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. Now we're thinking about Jerusalem. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't even know the number, but it's going to be too much. It is. It's going to be too much. It's going to be too hard. But don't buy the lie that says it's too hard, so we might as well not do it. Jesus has been defeating that lie for thousands of years. Let him do it again. If he says do it, let's do it. But that's just a building. What about your workplace? What about your home? What about your life? Anything. This can be applied to anything and everything. I hear people all the time, my tithe is not significant. Nonsense. Of course it is. God is not near as concerned about the amount of your tithe as he is the heart of you giving your tithe. Let him worry about what he wants to do with it. I read an article this week that literally broke my heart about tithing in America. In the Great Depression, per capita, the average Christian was given 3.5% of their income. Like, Pastor, that's not even a tithe. I know, give him a break. It was the Great Depression. And that was spread out amongst all Christians. Some were giving more, some were giving less, but on average it's 3.5%. 2016, arguably the most prosperous time in our nation's history. You know what Christians are giving on per capita? 2.5% of our annual income. What? Those who are going through the Great Depression were given 3.5%? And the most prosperous time you've ever even experienced, we're given 2.5%? This is insane to me. I literally wept when I read that. And it's not even about the money. It's about the heart. What if God convicted every believer in here and every believer in America to just give a minimum, just to give 10%? Let's say that happened. You know how much money we'd have? $165 billion. Like, what can you do with $165 billion? A lot. World hunger? We could probably beat it. Illiteracy? We could beat it in 3 to 5 years. All the sanitation and water issues? Eradicated. We could fully fund global missions right now and still have $100 billion left over for ministry expansion just with those funds in America for here and around the world. I'm not sharing those statistics to make you feel guilty. I'm just sharing it to say, what if? What if we all believed this even a little bit? And you think $165 billion is a lot? That's before you even take into account the multiplication that Jesus could do with it, as you see in this text. What you have is enough. And finally, I want to tell you, it's more than enough. With Jesus, our cup overflows. How many baskets full did they have left over? 12 basketfuls. It reminds me of the psalmist who says, you anoint my head with oil, and what does my cup do? It overflows in the midst of David's sin and his shame. Christ, God in Christ, was overflowing in his life. Jesus says in John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. That word abundantly means to the excess. Not only is it enough, but it's more than enough. Now you think, wait a second, Pastor, you're going all prosperity gospel on me. No. It's not saying that if you need a car, Jesus is going to give you 10 cars. Or if you need a car, he's going to give you excess. Now you're going to be driving that Lambo. The only reason you think like that is because you live in America where all the blessings that we think God gives are monetary. That's insane. What would you say to a believer who's in Afghanistan right now? Who's in Mali, Africa right now, starving, thirsty, and dying and being persecuted for their faith? What's their excess? They just don't pray enough. They don't have enough faith. That's nonsense. They have more than you and I probably will ever have. So what is their excess? Their excess is peace. Their excess is hope. Their excess is encouragement. That knowing that the worst the world can do to them is kill them, and they get to be with Jesus for eternity. They have enough peace, enough hope, enough encouragement, not only to get them through that situation, but it's more than enough. I ask you, what did they do with the 12 leftover baskets of bread in John chapter 6? You ever thought about that? What did they do with it? Did they take it home and hoard it and store it? No, it was bread, y'all. It only lasted 2 or 3 days. You know what they had to do with it? Oh, this is good. Get ready. You know what they had to do with it? They had to give it away. They had to give it away. Jesus gives you enough, and he gives you a more than enough. Why? So that you can give it away. If it's money, give it away, and don't be surprised if Jesus keeps giving it so you can give more of it away. If it's your time, give it. Don't be surprised if he gives you more so you can do what? Give it away. And if you say, I don't have anything else, you still have the gospel, you still have salvation. You have an abundance of peace, joy, hope, and encouragement. An abundance, excess. What should you do with it? Give it away.